Hello everyone, my name is Bishop Rebecca, and this is my final study series for my master's that I'm imparting to you. I'm doing the studying and I'm just giving you what I've learned so that you have it freely. And this today is called Eschatology Parts 1 and 2. It's just an introduction, and I'm going to be reading straight from the Word of God various passages which pretty much speak for themselves, with maybe a little bit of commentary here and there, but I like to just stick to the Word, and what the Word says is pretty clear, focusing mainly on the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so this is my last of this particular series, and in the fall I'm going to take off the month of August 2007, and I'm going to take some time with my family, and I really hope you have a wonderful summer. It's gorgeous out, and it's a great time for family, fun, you know, stuff like that. So I'm going to be taking the month off. I won't be posting any more videos or any blog talk radio shows for a month, and then I'm going to come back in the fall sometime after Labor Day, around Labor Day, and I'm going to be starting a new series. And this will be a weekly Christian counseling series, topical series. Won't be any longer than about 30 minutes. And I'll change topics every week. I'll have a theme that I speak on from the Word of God as a Christian counselor, and as a teaching, what I learn I impart from the Word of God that addresses certain topics and helps people to be able to look these things up for themselves and to be blessed and to impart that blessing to others, because we're blessed to be blessed. We're blessed to be blessings, and that all goes like a circle, you know. And so we're to be freely and, you know, giving people. So that's what this is about. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the last show on my master's degree series, and as well, it turns out I'm getting an honorary doctorate for it, so that's pretty good for the work that I've done in the teaching online with ministers over in Africa. And so what I'm doing is tonight Eschatology 1 and 2. It's just an introduction. And part of what I do as a teacher is impart methods, or if I find good methods, study methods for yourself to do Bible studies, give you ideas to start your own topical series and go deeper. Always go deeper in the Word of God. This is just to get us started. So I'm going to be working off of various scriptures, and I'm just going to read the scriptures as they are, but Matthew 24 speaks of the second coming of Jesus Christ and what we can expect. And I'm going to be doing 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians, a reading there from there. And I'm just going to do the reading. So Revelations 19-21, I believe it is. And that pretty well is giving us a good start. If you want to do a deeper study, I recommend that you get a concordance and look up any number of words or words related to words to do with a theme that you want to pursue. And look it up for yourself and see what the Word of God has to say. You may be greatly blessed. I did this once on joy, and I've done it on other words as well, but the one that comes to mind is joy, because I was having trouble with depression, recurring depressions, to do with loss, to do with grief, and overcoming grief. Part of overcoming for me was to get some answers on from Christian, you know, counseling from the Word of God to do with overcoming, say, depression or anxiety. And so what I did is I looked up the word joy and related words to joy, and I came up with about 600 scriptures that related to that, and I was very blessed by it. I copied them all out by hand. I wrote them all out, And it was just a total blessing to discover that joy in the spirit is independent of circumstances, for example. I've mentioned this in other videos I've done. But we learn to be able to rejoice in trials, hardships, and unlike happiness, which comes and goes and has to do with happenings. Joy in the spirit has to do with thanksgiving, with giving thanks for what we have and looking forward in faith to that God is going to work it all to the greater good, so claiming his promises. And the scriptures always had the word thanksgiving in them and holiness, which was interesting how joy, thanksgiving, and holiness always went together. Conversely, unholiness and unthankfulness always went together, and of course destruction. Destruction goes with that way. You know, because you're not overcoming, you're decompensating, or deteriorating, degenerating. It's all towards death that way. But we're going towards life, so that's what the fall I'll be doing Christian Counselling series. I think I may call it the Bride of Christ series or Bride of Christ series, because we as a church are the Bride of Christ, and so the reason I've decided tonight to do the eschatology 1 and 2, focusing on the second coming of Jesus Christ, because that's what we're waiting for. The kingdom of God is internal within, but it becomes a reality from without when the Lord Jesus Christ externally and physically returns. And then we have the resurrection of the dead and the marriage supper in heaven. And of course, there's the hell, you know. Jesus himself spoke of it, and I did a blog talk series on that. You may want to go to my blog talk radio series, or you can email me, you can message me at MySpace site, www.myspace.com/GMCBishopRebecca, all small letters, and that is where I post the videos on my site and also the blog talk radio series. And I have one on heaven and hell, and if you'd like that one, just message me from there and I'll send it to you via email or some way. I'll get it to you. Okay, so I have lots of different master's degree topics that I've done over there as well, so I can send you those if you'd like. And I had to study and dig, but you get the rewards if you want them. So Matthew 24, that's the kingdom of God, the coming kingdom of God, which is Matthew 24, signs of the end of this age. That's what I'm going to read you. So that we're not fooled. We know what the signs of the end of the age are. And so I'm going to get into that right now. Matthew 24, verse 4. These are Jesus Christ's words himself. Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye not be troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, or sin, the love of many shall wax cold. Because unbelief will grow, the trust will be destroyed. And in verse 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Where ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Stand in the holy place. Whoso read, let him understand. This is the Antichrist who will stand in the holy place. Let them which be in Judah flee into the mountains. Let him which is on the rooftop not come down. So he goes on to explain that this is going to be a very scary ordeal indeed. And picking it up at verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation, such as the world has not seen since the beginning of time, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there would be no flesh saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. Then if any man says to you, lo, here is Christ, don't believe it. For there shall rise many false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, inasmuch that, if it were possible, they deceive the very elect. Now when I do this, I'm just fixing something on the computer. Behold, I have told you before, wherefore if they say to you, behold, he's in the desert, don't go forth. Behold, he's in the secret chambers below, don't believe it. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shines unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. And so, it says immediately after the tribulation of those days, in verse 29, shall be the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. In other words, this is going to be devastating. There is no way we're going to miss the coming of Jesus Christ. The whole heavens and earth are going to shake with the power of his coming and the glory. And so it says, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, in verse 30. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heaven to the other. Now learn a parable of the fig tree, and then I'll let you go ahead and read that from verse 32 to 38. And then I'm going to pick it up again, that he says he's coming as a thief. And verse 37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Now how were the days of Noah? Well, eat, drink, and be merry. They were giving in marriage, everything was going on like normal. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. So they didn't believe it. And they knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so that also shall be the coming of the Son of Man. Then shall be two left in the field, one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding, one taken, the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord comes. Well, one thing's for sure, it's going to be obvious. And there are some people who are pre-tribulationists, mid-tribulationists, and post-tribulationists. And they have their evidence for each eschatology, called eschatology or end things. And some believe that there will be a rapture at each of those times. And so we're not going to get into that. You can look up tribulation and all that, because these are the deeper studies of God. This is an introductory study to do with the second coming of Jesus Christ, and basically references to heaven and hell and the great white throne judgment and the division of the two kingdoms, being the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Antichrist, which has presently usurped the world system today, and what is governing the world system today. And so now I'm going to pick it up to another eschatology subject, which will be Matthew 24:31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them, this would be King Jesus, the Messiah, on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry, thirsty, give you drink? When did we see you a stranger, took you in, or naked, and clothed you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison, and came unto you? And the king shall say, Jesus, and these are Jesus' very words, unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it to me. Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungered, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, you took me not in, naked, and you clothed me not, sick, and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they answer unto him, saying, Lord, when did we see you, hungry, athirst, stranger, naked or sick, and in prison, and did not minister unto you? And then he answered them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you did not do it for one of the least of these, mine, and he's speaking about his own children, the children of God, you did not do it to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Now the thing to take note of here is the arrogance of the people who said, for example, that are going to go into the eschatology or the ultimate destiny of hell, whether they claim to be Christians or not. Many of them, he says that he will say, depart from me, I never knew you evildoers, even though they say, well, we prophesied in your name, we preached and taught and we did this and that in your name. And he'll say, I never knew you, depart from me. So they're, final destiny would be hell. And the reason why is because they were never regenerated and born again in the spirit. They never humbled themselves before God, and God being Jesus Christ and the Savior, the Redeemer, King of the world. They did not recognize him, and they didn't humble themselves before him and become regenerated in order to do these works of ministry. And so these people, the only thing I want you to notice is that these people were quite arrogant. They couldn't believe they weren't going to heaven, whereas the other people, they didn't think it was any big deal. They were giving out of their love. They didn't really feel like they were working. So they were like, "But Lord, when did we do these things for you?" Because they didn't have that arrogant self-righteousness about it. They were not works. They weren't coming with works and all these. Although they had lots of works, but they did it because they cared, and they cared because their hearts were regenerated by the Lord Jesus Christ into the second life. They already had the kingdom of God operating in them, and so out of the love and the genuine love and compassion they had for others, they ministered to them, but they didn't think it was a big deal. They just imparted blessing because they were a blessing. God makes us alive to be a blessing to others, so his spirit comes in us, his love comes in us and comes through us, and so we just automatically minister. So that's why you see the works of faith. And so they had the works of faith. And the others, though, who maybe did this in their own righteousness, apart from the Spirit of God, apart from humbling themselves before Him and being born again by the power of the Spirit of God coming into them and quickening their spirit from death to life into His kingdom. Without that, even our works are dead. We're not saved by works. We're saved by grace. And so His Spirit comes in and saves us, regenerates us quite literally into His heart. That's called the circumcision of the heart, where we are now alive, lovers, translated from the kingdom of power and control, the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of self-righteous works and all that dead stuff, you know, into the kingdom of being made alive in the love of God. And so out of the love of God and the compassion and the mercy and the justice that's operating in us and through us, we don't think it's a big deal. We're ministering all the time, but we're not, you know, counting it like, say, self-righteous, pious, religious people would do. Whether they're atheists or whether they're humanists or whether they claim to be Christians, they're all unbelievers, all of them, that operate out of dead works, it's called. We're not saved by works. We're saved by the grace of God. He has to make us alive, so this humbles us all. You know, makes us all before God. He says, not one of you are righteous in and of yourself. And so, you know, He resists the proud, but He is self-righteous, but He gives grace to the humble. Power. The power of love, the power to redeem, the power to bless, the power to edify, build up, cast out demons in Jesus' name. You know, ultimate power, and to feed, to clothe, to minister. And so these are the things that you will see that come from the fruits of the Spirit. And so that First Thessalonians, that's what I'd like you to notice about that. That's the bride of Christ. Those are the true Christians. First Thessalonians 4:13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with Him. So our loved ones, now there's arguments about whether they're asleep or awake or are conscious or not. You know, the point is, the next waking thing you're going to remember is you're going to be present with the Lord. This is one thing for sure, what He says to do with our eschatology in His Word. And that we're going to be coming back here in the second coming of Jesus Christ, which is what's mentioned here. And so we're going to be literally raised from the dead, and this kingdom is going to go from an internal kingdom, which we have now. We're in one kingdom or the other right now. We're in either the kingdom of darkness or the kingdom of God right now. You know, we're not waiting for that. We don't die and go to heaven. We're there right now. You're either in the kingdom of God now or you're in the kingdom of Satan. And if you were to die, you would just go straight to his kingdom, which is hell. And you're following his ways, whether you know it or not. This law is in operation, the Word of God is in operation whether we know it or not. And Satan's well aware of the Scriptures. In fact, he was quoting them to Jesus. And he's been here the whole time. So he knows where we come from, he knows who we are, he knows what our issues are, and he works on keeping us ignorant. And so I did other videos, you know, to do with spiritual warfare 1 and 2, which are also posted at my site. And so, for the Lord himself, chapter 16, will descend from heaven with a shout. This is when his second coming now. With a voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, if we're still here, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words, to do with people who have passed away, saints who have passed away. Whether they're conscious, asleep, or awake, they're in Christ. And so the next thing they're going to remember is they're present with the Lord. So the absent with the body, we're present with the Lord. We're not really sure what happens in between. We'll have to find out. We will be finding out. So, unless we're alive when he comes back with a shout. Now, so if you see or hear someone saying, oh, there's the Christ over there, there's the Christ, Jesus Christ's words himself warns us. The second coming of Jesus Christ, he's going to touch down on the Mount Olives with his feet. That mountain's going to split apart. It's going to split apart from the power. The whole heavens and earth are going to shake. People are going to be mourning because they're going to see him in his glory coming. And the whole world will see him. It's described as lightning from the east to the west. This is not going to be something that you have to strain and, you know, no. He's not coming back as a lion this time. He's coming back as he's not coming back as the Lamb of God. He's coming back as the Lion, the Lion King. He's coming back to take his kingdom from Satan, who presently has usurped it and is in control of the world systems, or many of them right now in operation. And if he's not, you're having trouble, because these two kingdoms do not coexist peacefully. They're at war for dominance, one or the other. And then it goes on in 1 Thessalonians 2. I would like you to read chapter 2, that the man of sin or the Antichrist will be revealed. And he will actually be arrogant enough. The thing about Satan is he's arrogant and cocky and bold in the arrogant sense. Ultimately, he's a coward, but he's bold. Like a cockroach, if he thinks he can get away with it. That type of boldness, we all know, the mouthy, sassy, bold kind. Yeah, but not bold too long when the consequences are coming there where they're gone. You know, so they face nothing, you know, consequences. They don't face the music. These aren't the kind of people we're talking about here. So liars and cowards is the way of the wicked, you know. And so Satan being the father of that, it's his nature first, so anyone following those ways are actually following the ways of Satan. And so it talks about finally the man of sin that has to take the throne, because he can't stand it. I mean, he's self-righteous himself. He's an angel. He's referred to as an angel of light. He can't stand it that someone else might be getting any credit or glory, that as far as he's concerned, he's the king here. He's the king of this kingdom. He told Jesus that in the desert, you know, when Jesus was tested for 40 days to do with temptations. One of the things he said is, I own the whole world. And he has to boast, he has to brag, this is his nature. So he's not a feeder or someone that's going to be empowering and giving. He wants the credit and glory and everything. He's entitled. He's the absolute entitled king. You know, that's the kind of person he is, or being he is. If he were to take the form of a person, he's going to want credit. He's going to want to ascend right to the throne of God if he could. And he's not happy with what he has. He wants more, and it's a bottomless pit of greed with him, and envy and covetous, and he wants power and control. And so he's not a lover, he's not a giver, although he can pose as one. He can come as an angel of light, but there's no truth in him, you know. I mean, when the rubber hits the road, he's a liar and a coward. You know, he's not facing nothing. You know, he repents of nothing. He's not a repentant spirit. That takes guts. It takes, you know, to admit that you're wrong that maybe you haven't. And to give to other people, give the platform to other people who deserve credit and like that. But he's not a giver. He's not a feeder. So he's a devourer. He's the opposite energy. That's the difference between a black hole and a bright sun that warms the earth and creates life. That's the difference between God and Satan. I mean, you know, he's boring. And so we get into Revelations, where it speaks, if you want, you can read, you know, what's going to happen, starting in, I would say, start to read Revelations 17, where we've got the woman on the beast representing false religion and politics marrying together. They don't go together, but they're going to be merging together with one agenda. And so that's going to rise up, and the prophecy is going to be one of prosperity and peace. And without Jesus Christ on the throne, that's not possible. So that's a lie. The other thing that's going to happen is terrible persecution of the true saints of God that are alive at that time. And this is going to kick off the period of tribulation, the judgments that are going to pour out. So Revelation 17, and finally we get through all the tribulations and right up to the Battle of Armageddon, the thousand-year reign of Jesus Christ, where the devil is thrown into hell, and for 1,000 years Jesus reigns, and then there's going to be the millennial reign and in 20. You can read that if you want. Then Satan's going to be loosed for a short time, and that's when the ultimate battle between good and evil is going to happen. And of course, you know, God's going to reign. After Armageddon, after the final battle, and then the great white throne judgment is going to happen, where God's going to, as I read in Matthew, separate the sheep from the goats, and this is chapter 20. And then, well, that's just going to be done with. We're not going to remember any of that. We're our memories, we got a choice which place we go. In hell, it will be something you're never able to forget, this life and all the stupid choices that led to where you find yourself. Hopefully it's not there, but there are people there right now as we speak, millions and millions of people there. And so, you know, it's a real place. Once you enter into eternity, according to the words of Jesus Christ, and you have to do something with him, because he's the one here who's God the Son, coming back, who gave his life, and is coming back for his church bride. And so this is where the great white throne judgment comes, where he is the king of his kingdom. This other kingdom is going to be thrown out, because although Satan's powerful, he is not God. Jesus Christ is God. Jesus Christ is God the Son. And so it pleased God to use the foolishness of the world, to quote another part of the Bible here, in order to accomplish the wisdom of God. It's foolishness to those perishing. Probably most of all the devil, because he's a liar and murderer, and he can't believe that, you know, God's actually going to accomplish this by being crucified on the cross, because he knew who he was, so he can never figure out what's going on, you know. And then Revelations was written, and now he's quite well versed with this one. He knows what's ahead. And so, you know, the devils believe and tremble, though. We have to obey, because he's not just Redeemer, he's King. So he's going to be enthroned, and in his own kingdom. This is his creation. Nothing's going to usurp that. And anything trying that's going into, it's warned, hell. But there was a choice, so there's no way to blame when there's a choice. And this is eschatology. Eschatology meaning the end destiny. So then there's going to be the great white judgment to do with the kingdom of God coming physically into manifestation now in the universe. The whole universe is going to burn up. In Revelations, it speaks of this, the whole universe burning up and being recreated into the new Jerusalem then. And death, sin, hell, all that stuff that leads to death, the second death it's called, is going into the pit, into hell. And there are some people who argue, well, I did a study on heaven and hell. Some people argue, well, you know, maybe it means that there's, you know, that people don't burn, or the devil and people that are in there don't that chose to be there don't burn forever, that they actually are just annihilated at that point from turning from ashes from the inside out, which the Bible speaks of, is the second death. It's the heart death. And so I don't think it much matters for this study. This is just an introductory study, and it does. There are differences of opinion, and there's valid observations that people have that maybe it is final, the final end, or maybe it is continual burning. I mean, and then there's other people that, you know, say, well, the fire is not real fire. It's actually just burning lust, always burning in your lust, unfulfilled, unrequited lusts, or whatever, and that's what hell is. But you know, the fact is, we don't know. And we're going to find out. A lot of this is revelation, so we're going to have to find this out. It's a mystery when we get there. But what I can tell you for sure is that the concrete things that are going to happen are the things that I've just mentioned. And finally, the New Jerusalem. This is going to be an actual physical kingdom on earth. And it's the city of God. And the streets are paved with gold, and there's no such thing as the rich and the poor. God is a gazillionaire, obviously. He owns everything. It's just an illusion that right now, because the devil has usurped the earth, that you have the haves with a lot, and mostly the have-nots, many of whom are right now, as we speak, dying of starvation. And in heaven, it's not like that. In heaven, the very streets are paved with gold, and the kingdom of God is not going to be possible without King Jesus on the throne, the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity taking the throne. And we're going to have learned, one thing we're going to have learned is that we're absolutely done with the idea that we don't need God, that we have the wisdom to deal with the knowledge of good and evil, that we are capable of making choices like that. No, we're going to be deceived. And that's what happened in the garden, and what's going to end up happening is that we're going to live with Him forever, for those of us who belong to Him. And if you don't belong to Him right now, just humble yourself before Him. Admit that you're a sinner. Admit that you need salvation. He came here to pay the price for anyone. Children are automatically paid for. Anyone who's innocent, and anyone who's seeking real righteousness, knowing that you've maybe tried it all. You've tried all your self-righteousness and your good works, and you still do not have life. You do not have the life of God in you. You are not quickened to life. And so you don't understand the things of the Spirit. You can read them, and the Bible says they'll be gibberish to you if you do not have the Holy Spirit within you. And this also is for people who grew up in religious homes and upbringing. That can be the most dangerous and make you very self-righteous. Self-righteousness isn't getting us anywhere. That's called humanism and vain philosophies and deceits and whatever. In the Bible, it's called vain philosophies and deceits. If you're not on the rock of Jesus Christ, and you do not have, if you have not humbled yourself before God, your parents can't save you. If their religion cannot save you, their salvation cannot save you, you must make the choice. We must make the choice past the age of accountability. God's covered the innocent. So the innocent, the children, are automatically covered. But for those of us that go past the age of accountability, we must humble ourselves before Him and ask for His mercy. And He will say to the Father, I've paid for them. So we've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. If you can admit that you've violated one or all of those Ten Commandments or any of them, and honestly, in all consciousness, seek Lord for mercy, no arrogance, but you seek Him for mercy, and then you find a good church. You ask Him to come in. He will come in. He'll make you alive, because He knows the genuine from the ungenuine. So He's going to come into somebody. It's not about, you know, ritual, rote, anything. We're not saved by works, and we're sure not saved by flattery and words. So if you ask him in all genuineness, if you're not sure you're saved, Jesus, I'm a sinner. This is the first thing you have to admit. There'll be no proud and arrogant people coming before him. We've already read what's going to happen. Anyone tries that, because he owes no one anything. A life is a gift. So we have to come to him with respect and reverence and ask him, Jesus, please come into my heart and save me. And ask him for his Holy Spirit, and he will bring his Holy Spirit in. And it's best if you use your own words. As awkward as they are, they're the words of a babe, and those are precious to God. You know, those are the words of his children, and you're his child. And so you speak to him from your spirit, and he will quicken your spirit alive in the Holy Spirit, and then his life, his words will, because he makes you alive to his kingdom. You've instantly translated kingdoms. You're now in the kingdom of God. Now your eschatology is towards heaven. It's not, if you die, you're not going to, you know, with Satan, because we're born in original sin. So we're not going to be able to do anything else. We're not going to be able to be the kind of people God wants unless we have his spirit leading and guiding us 24/7, which comes into us once we ask for his mercy as sinners, and then we become the children of God, and then it's his business how he's going to direct us 24/7, because he'll be living. We become the house of God. His spirit comes to live in us. So just say, Jesus, I would like you to come in. Please come in. I need you. And not, you know, not out of any kind of usury, but you get to a place where you have to acknowledge you need him. At some point in your life, nothing else has brought satisfaction. So there's an emptiness there. It's called a God-shaped vacuum in us. And so if you call on his name, and you do it in sincerity, and you come as a sinner, he'll make you a saint. Just like that. You'll translate kingdoms just like that. You go from sinner to saint, from darkness to light, from the kingdom of hell, following Satan, not realizing it, half the time ignorant, and you know, into the kingdom of heaven. Your eschatology, or your eschatology, changes from destruction to eternal life. And it's all in Christ Jesus. And he's the king. There's one king. But there's many peoples and many cultures, and he loves diversity, as you can see around. He says you're without excuse, because you can see me in the creation. You can see very well what I must be like, you know. So anyone who's not seeking him, you know, it's like a thief taking the gift of life, not wondering, don't I have someone to thank, you know, for everything he's given us, all that we are and have. And so all you have to do is just humbly seek him, and he'll do the rest. He'll lead you, he'll guide you. In fact, we can't come to him unless he's wooing us to begin with. So if you feel compelled to say the prayer, the sinner's prayer, which is that you need Jesus as a sinner, in your own words, as a babe, Jesus, please come in, please save me, make me alive in your Holy Spirit. He'll make you alive. Suddenly this word will come alive to you. You'll understand what used to be gibberish. And then find yourself a good church and be baptized, because that is a command of God, that we're baptized. Because it's our public confession, we must confess it then before men, in order for him to confess us before the Father as our advocating attorney. And so we've switched kingdoms, we've switched kings, from King Satan over there, the egomania, the proud, self-righteous one, to King Jesus, the one who took the form of a man and even took the death on the cross as a criminal, as a sinner in our place, having known no sin, but became sin for us, in order that he might pay for the ones that are coming to him, the ones that the Father's given him, which are the ones who come to him, either the children or the ones that come to him in sincerity and humility, asking for salvation from King Jesus, and he will save you. And so that's my talk, and thank you very much for listening. I'm going to, this is the final talk in my series to do with my master's degree series, and I hope it's been a blessing to you, and more than anything, than what I myself have said, because I'm just the messenger, more than anything, what I hope is it leads you to getting into deeper studies for yourself in the Word of God, as led by His Holy Spirit, for those of you who belong to Him, and for those of you who don't come into the kingdom, because He'll get you, without Him, we're not getting through anything. But with Him, we're getting through everything. We're going to be more than overcomers, more than conquerors, He says. Greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world, so there's nothing we're not going to overcome, including sin, Satan, the world system in operation right now, and finally death. And one day, we'll be in His glorious kingdom, where the streets are paved with gold. There's no rich and poor. There's none of that. There's no, none of that. It's all, what to us right now is utopia. But it will be real. It will be a real utopia. So, real, you know, concrete. And there will be no more death. No more tears, no more suffering. We'll just be free to pursue our creative pursuits. We're created to be like Him, little creators. So we won't have all these hindrances to worry about. We'll be on about the Father's business, which is creating and discovering and learning. And that's what we will be doing. We'll be going from glory to glory over there, you know. And over there is over here right now. So the kingdom of God is within you, but so also is the kingdom of Satan. So, that one leads to death, and the road to life is narrow and hard, as Jesus said, but well worth it. It's the pearl of great price, and he's the greatest pearl of all. And so, with that, thank you very much for listening to my master's degree series, and I hope I've been a blessing to you. I've just introductory touched on all these topics. There's much more to discover and study. If you go to my blogs and my links at www.myspace.com/GMC Bishop Rebecca, all small letters, you will find that you can go to seminary for yourself for free, and you can learn from world-class scholars the Word of God, and you can go all the way through to doctorate degrees if that's your desire. And I'm starting my second doctorate starting this September, doing that very thing through Life Bible School or North American Theological Society, but both of them connected with trinitytheology.org. If you go to www.trinitytheology.org, and he has a lot of, he's a physicist that's also a theologian, but he has a lot of seminaries worldwide and free Christian resources and materials out there for people who want to show themselves approved and learn about God and learn of God and of Jesus Christ, our King, and who starts in Genesis and goes all the way through the Revelations. There aren't enough libraries in the world to contain it. And all of our systems of thought that come, they come from the ancients. All of our systems of thought. They're either deviants off of it or whatever. But all of the great thought systems of the world come from the study of God. And so I'm doing my second doctorate coming up in September. But in September I'm going to start short topical series, not longish like these ones have been, but short topical series as a Christian counselor. Christian counselor, I have a blog talk radio show, Christian Counselor Live. And if you go to my space site, you'll find it. But I'll give you the URL for that. It's www.blogtalkradio.com/bishop-Rebecca, all small letters except the B and the R are capitalized for Bishop Rebecca. And I'm going to be doing that as a Christian counselor, starting topical series in September, in a month from now, September 07. And going to do it on various topics, not sure what. I don't know if I'm going to call, I might call the topical series Bride of Christ, or I might call it Christian Counselor Live, which is what I call my blog talk radio show. I may call it Christian Counselor or something along those lines, but it will be a let you know that these are Christian Counseling series, and they'll be on various subjects from the Word of God. Just short little talks, studies that I do on various topics, or topics within topics, something like that. And I'm going to upload these videos always to VO as long as possible, and Google, and anywhere, any of my other websites. I'm going to also internet archives. I have uploaded most of my sermons that I could there to there, and Blip TV, and there's just a whole bunch of places, websites that I have and stuff. So thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to starting to these series for both Blog Talk Radio and also video series starting in September, in a month from now after summer's over. And we're going to have a wonderful summer, my family and I, and our little dog. So thank you very much for listening, and have a wonderful summer with your family. And remember something.